Welcome to the video. We are going to get into a very intense full blast practice, phase four practice here, exercise actually. But before we do so, a little talk, a little context, if that's possible. The exercise will be in the form of I am greater than any. This morning the Holy Spirit gave me this exercise. I was feeling kind of stuck. I was realizing that the essential trap that we're in. A little bird has just arrived. That's good. The essential trap that we're in. We get pulled down. The whole realm of delusion is an entropic dream. The whole dream is an entropic dream. Its purpose is to pull us down deeper and deeper, deeper into delusion. And what I found out is that the world, when they say, help, 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 we need help, we need help, we need help, calling up to the so-called higher layers and levels of this dream. What they're really saying is, we don't want any help at all. And we view you as possibly being able to give us help. So what we need for you to do is come down here to this so-called lower realm and be as confused as we are. So help us by not being able to help us. This is the entropic nature of this dream. This is the trick of it all. And so we're up there. We may be up there in the so-called higher levels of spiritual duality of this dream. But we're always being called from below, like, help, help. We're so trapped. Help, help. And we think, oh, I need to go down and help them. But what we need to realize is the call from help from this dream, the call from help is help. We have a terrible continuity problem. We don't want to wake up. If we wake up, we'll fall into an absolute abyss of annihilation. So please help us by coming down here and sharing our insanity. Please help us by sharing our confusion. Please help us by not being able to help us. This is the trick. This is how this whole entropic dream keeps cycling and cycling and cycling. So this was, realized this yesterday at the end of a taping, and, you know, it's a bitter pill to swallow, but it's a good pill to swallow. It's very true. It's very true. So I must say, no, I am not going to put myself in a position of not being able to help you. See, what they want is us to be unhelpful. They want no help whatsoever to be available. So they're not tempted to let go of the stance of hallucination, which they feel, the continuity fear, makes us feel as if we will be nothing. We'll cease to exist. Since we think that we're arising, we're a product of this appearance. And if we realize that appearance is mere appearance and nothing more, and it is arising from our desire to experience, for experiencing, we have this continuity issue of thinking we won't exist. So the dream is screaming all the time, help, 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 help us get rid of help, help us get rid of help, help us get rid of help. Please, will you not help us get rid of help? This is the mantra of this dream. Will you please help us get rid of help? Help us get rid of help. Which is essentially mean help us get rid of reality. Help us get rid of God. God beyond God. Right? Because we have only concepts, ideas. This whole dream is only viewing God as wanting to get rid of God, actually. So we don't really know God, are aware of God at all. And so our practicing needs to, first of all, what I found is I was getting trapped this morning. I went back through the continuity exercise and it freed me right away. So I would say the continuity practice is the best practice that I know of. And say, and we must insist, my only problem is the continuity problem. I have no other problem. Insist on that. Not just say it, insist upon it. You see, in exercises, we're not just saying something, we're insisting upon it. This makes all the difference, is to insist your will, your spirit, your determination, your, see, I insist the only problem I have is a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem there is. Not just for me, for this whole dream, actually. And the dream is nothing but a misinterpretation from the standpoint of hallucination, which is basically the desire to replace God as prime creator. So insist, I only have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. I have no other problem. The continuity problem is the only problem there is. There is no other problem. There is no other problem. Insist upon it. And you will find even the seemingly the most horrible traps that seem to be devouring you, suddenly you spring free. You spring free of it. It's like it's not even there. It's not even there. Which is true, because you're insisting the only problem I have is a continuity problem. I have no other problem. And so these other problems that are trying to devour you, suddenly you insist they're not there. I don't have those problems. They don't exist. The only problem I have is a continuity problem. The only problem there is the continuity problem. Insist upon it, and the clouds simply just vanish. It's truly a miraculous approach that you will only know through doing it and insisting upon it. And then from that insistence, the clouds parted, and then I asked the Holy Spirit, do you have an exercise for us? Yes, yes. It started with, I am greater than. I am greater than any teacher. Okay. I said, wow. Yeah, that's great. I am greater than any teacher. I am greater than any teacher. Say this. Insist upon it. Don't say it. Insist upon it. We start out with the continuity confession. I have a severe problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. I have no other problem. There is no other problem. The continuity problem is the only problem there is. I have no other problem. I am greater than any teacher. I am greater than any teacher. So we start out with this form. I am greater than any teacher. And we can start out, I am greater than any God. I am greater than any God. Okay. Because remember, we only have ideas, images, thoughts, concepts, words, and a hallucinatory stance towards God. Okay. Remember, God is greater than God. God doesn't need to be God. God is greater than God. We cannot grasp God in any way possible. Okay, there is no viewpoint upon God. So when we say I am greater than God, means I am greater than any viewpoint of God. Okay? We're trapped in what we feel is a viewpoints. Okay. We need to have a viewpoint or a stance. That is not true. So I am greater than God. Start out with the chakra. You know, wow, I am greater than God. I am greater than goddess. I am greater than goddess. I am greater than any goddess. I am greater than God goddess. I am greater than God goddess. Know it. It is true. I am greater than God goddess. I I am greater than greatness. I am greater than greatness. I am greater than any teacher. I am greater than any teacher. I am greater than any teaching. I am greater than any teaching. I am greater than I am. I am greater than I am. I am greater than greatness. I am greater than greatness. I am greater than any place. I am greater than any place. I am greater than any time. I am greater than any time. I am greater than any space. I am greater than any space. I am greater than any transmission. I am greater than any transmission. I am greater than any transmitter. I am greater than any transmitter. Insist upon it. So as I say these, I'll say them twice and then a little time for you to say them twice. I am greater than any form. I am greater than any form. I am greater than any non-form. I am greater than any non-form. I am greater than any formlessness. I am greater than any formlessness. I am greater than light. I am greater than light. I am greater than darkness. I am greater than darkness. I am greater than guru. I am greater than guru. I am greater than any master. I am greater than any master. I am greater than any savior. I am greater than any savior. I am greater than any deity. I am greater than any deity. I am greater than nature. I am greater than nature. I am greater than any world. I am greater than any world. I am greater than any star. I am greater than any star. I am greater than any universe. I am greater than any universe. I am greater than energy. I am greater than energy. I am greater than being. I am greater than being. I am greater than knowledge. I am greater than knowledge. I am greater than wisdom. I am greater than wisdom. I am greater than thought. I am greater than thought. I am greater than image. I am greater than image. I am greater than mind. I am greater than mind. I am greater than truth. I am greater than truth. I am greater than anything. I am greater than anything. I am greater than what can be said. I am greater than what can be said. I am greater than feeling. I am greater than feeling. I am greater than sensation. I am greater than sensation. I am greater than motion. I am greater than motion. I am greater than action. I am greater than action. I am greater than the middle. I am greater than any middle. I am greater than wellness. I am greater than wellness. I am greater than thatness. I am greater than thatness. I am greater than suchness. I am greater than suchness. I am greater than revelation. I am greater than revelation. I am greater than miracles. I am greater than miracles. I am greater than hallucination. I am greater than hallucination. I am greater than appearance. I am greater than appearance. I am greater than oneness. I am greater than oneness. I am greater than spirit. I am greater than spirit. I am only greatness. I am only greatness. And I am only greatness. I am only greatness greater than greatness. I am only greatness greater than greatness, greater than greatness, greater than greatness, greater than greatness, greater than greatness. I don't need greatness. I don't even need greatness. I am so great, I don't even need greatness. And this brings us right into another practicing is reality doesn't need reality. God doesn't need God. Truth doesn't need truth. Spirit doesn't need spirit. Oneness doesn't need oneness. Again, God doesn't need God. Reality doesn't need reality. Oneness doesn't need oneness. Truth doesn't need truth. I am doesn't need I am. Perfection doesn't need perfection. Spaciousness doesn't need spaciousness. Reality is beyond reality. Doesn't even need beyondness. In other words, there is nothing we can say about it. There is nothing we can express about it whatsoever. And this is as far as any exercise or any words can take us. But we certainly have to be comfortable with that. This is the phase four. This is full blast phase four here. It started out by realizing the Holy Spirit said, say this, I am greater than any teacher. I am greater than any teacher. And when I mean everyone. We all are. When I'm saying I mean I want you to practice this. Everyone to practice this. I want you to say, I am greater than any teacher. This is an exercise for everyone. For everyone. I am greater than any teacher. I am greater than any teaching. I am greater than any teaching. I am greater than any God. I am greater than any goddess. I am greater than any God goddess. I am greater than any deity. I am greater than any light. I am greater than any light. I am greater than any appearance. I am greater than any action. I am greater than any crusade. I am greater than any enlightenment. I am greater than any enlightenment. Okay, there's a good one. I am greater than any enlightenment. I am greater than any teacher. I am greater than any teaching. I am greater than any greatness. I am greater than any greatness. I am greater than any greatness. I am greater than any heart. I am greater than any heart. I am greater than any oneness. I am greater than any allness. I am greater than any totality. I am greater than greatness. What we're doing here is we're getting comfortable with relinquishing the stance of hallucination, actually. With relinquishing that. This is all that we're doing. Because this entire dream, with all its gods and goddesses and god goddesses and deities and realms and supposed layers and levels and supposed depth, all this, you know, dimensions, etc., etc., all of this is merely a defense that is holding, justifying, and holding the stance of hallucination in place. That's all that it is. And any teachers that appear and any teaching that appears, all of that still is arising in the context of the dream. So to relinquish, you know, there's nothing that the teachers want more than for us to declare, I am greater than any teacher. I am greater than any teacher. I am greater than any appearance. I am greater than any teaching. I am greater than any transmission. I am greater than any meditation. I am greater than any meditation. I am greater than any book. I am greater than any writing. I'm greater than any prayer. I'm greater than any exercise. I'm greater than any technique. I'm greater than any need. I am greater than any need. This is direct practicing on relinquishing the stance of hallucination, which I clarified yesterday, which I shared the clarification. It was a shared clarification. I am greater than any I. I am greater than any I. I am greater than any I am. I am greater than any I am not. I am greater than any transcendence. I am greater than any realization. I am greater than any realization. You see, in this dream of spiritual duality, there's all sorts of gods and goddesses and deities and realizations and enlightenment and transcendence and recognition and teaching and teachers and transmission. It's just endless, you know. I am greater than all that. I am greater than any dream. I am greater than any dream. I am greater than any relativity. All of this is only relative. It's all spiritual duality, relativism. There's no absoluteness in the context of a dream whatsoever. None. The whole purpose of the dream is to hold the inherent dualistic delusion of the stance of hallucination, is to hold that in place. It's the whole purpose of it. It's delusional from the very beginning. I am greater than any delusion. I am greater than any non-delusion. So we have to work on this relativity of this dream, where you have these supposed higher levels of the dream, where these gods and goddesses and god goddesses seem to be transmitting enlightenment to the lower levels, etc. But this is only actually to maintain their stance within the dream, their positioning in the dream, which maintains the positioning of the lower levels of the dream. And the whole dream is essentially entropic, okay? It's essentially entropic, where the higher, supposed higher, gets progressively pulled down to the lower. You see? And the supposed being pulled up to the higher is only for the purpose of cycling back into the lower. So it's an entropic cycling. Is what it is. It's a ceaseless entropic cycling that has no escape velocity at all, within its context. And so the practice is to deal with both polarities of the duality and the middle. I say, I am greater than this. I am greater than lightness. I am greater than darkness. I am greater than the middle. I am greater than the middle. I am greater than the gods. I am greater than the goddesses. I am greater than the god-goddesses. I am greater than the higher. I am greater than the lower. I am greater than the in-between. I'm greater than the greater, I'm greater than the lesser, I'm greater than the in-between. And again, I forgot to mention this, I'm greater than remembrance, I'm greater than forgetfulness, I'm greater than the in-between. You can use this practice all the time, can't you? Yeah, it's one of these exercises you can use all during the day, just like the continuity exercise. I forgot to mention though, full stop in the now. Full stop in this nowness of the exercise. Okay. You're not greater, you're not lesser, you're not in between. You're full stop in the nowness, which is inexpressibleness. You're full stop in the inexpressibleness. Okay. You're resting on the groundless ground of inexpressibleness. You're resting on the ground which is based on nothing being brought to rest. Okay. You're released from resting, from nothing being brought to rest. So what we call just full stop in the now, full stop in the burn, full stop in the burn, as we try to come up with some expression, something to grasp, something to grab hold of, some relative position, some viewpoint. We rest in the viewpoint released from nothing, no viewpoint being found, from no viewpoint being found at all. Now, the graciousness of grace is responsible for our capacity to do these exercises, actually do them, to insist upon them. Not just do them, insist upon it. You must have this fiery insistence, calm, fiery insistence. Not an emotional fire, but a calm fire. It's kind of like you see the welders with that settling torch, and it's a very calm flame, isn't it? Very focused, calm flame. It's not flickering all over like this, you know, like a fire. It's just steady, calm, smooth flame. But that flame is very hot, melts metal. Have that kind of flame. Insist. The only problem there is the continuity problem. There is no other problem. No other problem exists whatsoever. None. The continuity problem is simply fear of being free. The fear of being free is what it really is. Free of any viewpoint whatsoever. We don't need a viewpoint. I'm greater than any viewpoint. I'm greater than any non-viewpoint. I'm greater than any god. I'm greater than any non-god. I'm greater than any goddess. I'm greater than any non-goddess. I'm greater than any teacher. I'm greater than any non-teacher. And greater than any in-between. Greater than any in-betweenness. Greater than any in-betweenness. I'm greater than any light. I'm greater than any non-light. I'm greater than any darkness. I'm greater than any non-darkness. I'm greater than any in-betweenness. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. It's the only problem there is. The continuity problem is the only problem I have. It's the only problem there is. I am greater than any teacher. I'm greater than any non-teacher. I'm greater than any in-betweenness. I'm greater than any teaching. I'm greater than any non-teaching. I'm greater than any in-between. Any in-betweenness. Or any non-in-betweenness also. So from one standpoint, from the relative standpoint, it seems absurd, because the relative standpoint is trying to develop a position within relativity. You see, this dream of really this hallucinatory stance is trying to develop a viewpoint which it can then claim is God, you know, is it, is I am, is freedom. But the problem is, when trying to develop a viewpoint, your freedom comes from insisting that nobody else has as great a viewpoint as you. And so you feel free to feel that you're the greatest based on a viewpoint. So we insist, I am greater than any guru. I am greater than any avatar. Okay, I am greater than any avatar. I am greater than any avatar. Say it. Insist upon it. Don't say it. Insist. I insist I am greater than any avatar. I am greater than any greatest avatar. I am greater than the greatest avatar. Right? I am greater than any non-avatar. I am greater than any non-avatar. Okay? I am greater than any in-betweenness. I am greater than no in-betweenness. Full stop in the now. Now, if you struggle with any of this, that's good. We're supposed to. I'm trying to find something which is that we're going to struggle with, so we feel the burn, right? I don't want it to be completely easy. So I'm trying to find anything at all. Where are we stuck? Where are we stuck? So we can feel the stuckness. Say, whoa, I'm stuck there. Whoa, stop, I gotta stop. Whoa, you know, and then wow. Not whoa, but wow. See, we're going from whoa to wow. From whoa to wow. And then we just full stop in the burn, full stop in the now. Full stop in the now, free now. Full stop in the now, free now that is neither now nor not now. Full stop in the now, free now that is neither now nor not now, nor any middle, nor any excluded middle. Yeah, it's neti, neti, neti. Not this, not this, not that is the way. That is profound. I am greater than any not this. I'm greater than any this. I'm greater than any not this. I'm greater than any in-betweenness. I'm greater than any non-in-betweenness. And so, of course, full stop in the now, which is no viewpoint at all, right? Which is freedom from viewpoint. Freedom from viewpoint. Freedom from viewpoint. Which is really freedom from hallucination. The stance of hallucination. Hallucination is just an idle wish, a demand. That the concurrent arising of appearance with the desire of experiencing is actually the causal to the desire for the experiencing. It's not causal in that way, no. You can say there is no cause to it. It is reality. It is simultaneous. Just as the Son is simultaneous with the Father, but the Father is primary. The desire for extension doesn't come from the extension itself. It becomes from the desire for extension, yet the extension is simultaneous with the desire for extension. Now, I am greater than any madman. I am greater than any madman. I am greater than any non-madman. I am greater than any mad woman. I am greater than any non-mad woman. I am greater than any adept. I am greater than any non-adept. I am greater than any middle. I am greater than any excluded non-middle. I am greater than any wisdom. I am greater than any non-wisdom. I am greater than any crazy wisdom. I am greater than any non-crazy wisdom. I am greater than any middle. I am greater than any non-middle. I am greater than any excluded middle. I am greater than than any insanity. I am greater than any non-insanity. I am greater than any transcendence. I am greater than any non-transcendence. I am greater than any middle. I am greater than any excluded middle. So, full stop in the burn. Hopefully some of this has jarred loose. You're woken us up like, wow, shock treatment. This is, you know, this is full blast, fourth phase, shock treatment, beyond shock treatment. I'm greater than any shock treatment. This is, it's even beyond shock treatment, actually. It's beyond viewpoint. I'm greater than any viewpoint. I'm greater than viewpoint. I'm greater than non-viewpoint. And we're feeling, hey, I can't express it. Yeah, it's not expressible. It cannot be put into. It can either be put into nor not put into. So you can either be put into nor not put into nor any middle. So in any practice we do, we should insist upon it to such an extent that we then begin to get this burn, consternation, sort of flustered, you know, this inner being feeling flustered, and we just rest in that. We just rest in the now free now that is neither now nor not now, the release that is free of release. For absence of anything to release. We rest in the release that is free of release, absent of anything to release, absent of anything brought to release, absent of any release brought to release. I am free of any mind games. I am greater than any mind games. I am greater than any non-mind games. I am greater than any mind games. I am greater than any mind games. I am greater than any non-mind games. I am greater than any middle. I am greater than any excluded middle. Now this is just a practice, so understand it is a practice. It is evaporating the continuity fear. And I am greater than any practice. I am greater than any non-practice. So, truly, all of us, we are greater than greatness. And we have to assert this ourselves. Don't get caught up into worshiping some deity, okay? Don't worshiping some goddess, some goddess, some avatar, some crazy avatar. Whatever it is, don't get caught up in any viewpoint, even the viewpoint of a crazy avatar. Don't even get caught up in that viewpoint. I am greater than any viewpoint. I am greater than any craziness. I'm greater than any divine wisdom. I'm greater than divinity. I am greater than divinity. I am greater than divinity. I am greater than divine wisdom. I am greater than divine wisdom. I am greater than non-divinity. I am greater than non-divinity. I am greater than divinity. I am greater than non-divinity. I am greater than crazy divinity. I am greater than non-crazy divinity. And so we really do have to work on this. Have some faith, okay? You must have some faith that this sharing is for a purpose. Asking the Holy Spirit, knowing the stuckness that we are feeling, having felt it myself for so long and looking at it, asking the Holy Spirit, can you give us something to work on to help with the stuckness, to help with our continuity fear, which is having us hold on to the stuckness. This is working. This will work. One more. I forgot one thing to say. I am greater than any abundance. I am greater than abundance. I am greater than any abundance. I am greater than any non-abundance. I am greater than any non-abundance. I am greater than any middleness. I am greater than any non-middleness. I am greater than any good fortune. I am greater than any misfortune. I am greater than any middleness, in-betweenness. I am greater than any great fortune. I am greater than any great misfortune. I am greater than any friendship. I am greater than any friendship. I am greater than any non-friendship. I am greater than any non-friendship. I am greater than any in-betweenness. I am greater than any experience. I am greater than any experience. I am greater than any non-experience. I am greater than any experiencing. I am greater than any non-experiencing. I am greater than any in-betweenness. I am greater than any good times. I am greater than any bad times. I am greater than any meeting. I am greater than any non-meeting. I am greater than any grace. I am greater than any non-grace. I'm greater than any in-betweenness. I am greater than any seriousness. I am greater than any seriousness. I'm greater than any concentration. I'm greater than any focus. I'm greater than any determination. I am greater than any virtue. I am greater than any virtue. I'm greater than any non-virtue. And I'm greater than any exercise. I'm greater than any non-exercise. I'm greater than any motivation. I'm greater than any non-motivation. I'm greater than any motivator. I'm greater than any non-motivator. So it's very important to insist upon all this, to free yourself from the stance of hallucination and everything that holds that in place, including the highest of the highest of the highest as it starts out, where it seems to be free of the entropy, but it's not. I'm greater than any vanishment. I am greater than any vanishment. I am greater than any vanishment. So in this cyclic, entropic cycle, there has to be high and there has to be low for it to be cycling, so that we have this delusion of freedom, a false freedom. Oh, I'm going up now. But then I'm being pulled back down. You see, it's like that. It keeps cycling. Because we know we want to be free. So we have to account for our desire for freedom by making it seem as if we're going up, but then we go back down, you see. It's entropic, it's an entropic cycle. So we have to be free of the highest part of this entropic cycle, where those who this, as the cycle pushes up those to the highest, so-called highest level, before that then they go past the apex and then start going down to the lower, descending down lower. As they get up to that higher, they think, wow, you know, I'm liber, I'm the greatest. So you reach that point and you feel, I'm the greatest. And I need to tell everybody that I'm the greatest. And so they will, we can occasionally get the situation where that comes into the world and says, I need to tell everybody I'm the greatest. Okay. So we need to insist upon this, our practicing, insist upon what we're practicing, and say, no, I don't have a greatest problem. I have a continuity problem. I do not have a greatest problem. I have a continuity problem. The greatest problem has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. So from the pragmatic standpoint, we will at least accept one viewpoint. Okay, from the pragmatic standpoint, which we have to use because of the continuity fear, and that is the vision of oneness, the vision of oneness. So we are not trying to say we're greater than pragmatism, all right? And the pragmatic resolution to this problem is the vision of oneness. What we're doing is practicing to free ourselves from this entropic cycle, which has high points also, and these high points feel that they're greater than all the lower viewpoints, you see. And so they like to trap us in the higher viewpoint, in acknowledging the greatness of the higher viewpoint. So this is what we have to practice on. And shunt that aside for the vision of oneness, okay. You see, because the highest viewpoint insists it's the greatest viewpoint, but wants to trap everybody in viewpoints, the viewpoint of recognizing that they have the greatest viewpoint. That's a viewpoint. The viewpoint of acknowledging that they have the greatest viewpoint is still a viewpoint. We must be free of that. We do not want that. The viewpoint of saying, oh, I have the viewpoint that you are the greatest teacher, that you have the greatest viewpoint. That's the trap. That's the trap. So pragmatically, we say, no, I don't have a viewpoint problem, I have a continuity problem. Okay, I don't have a greatness problem, I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem there is. The greatness problem doesn't exist. Therefore has no value. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Not the viewpoint that of the great viewpoint has no value for me, has zero value for me. The viewpoint of acknowledging the great viewpoint has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. This protects us from the viewpoint, the highest viewpoint of this entropic cycle of delusion, of spiritual duality. Spiritual duality is this cycling of high and low, high and low. Now, if you got up to the highest viewpoint as you're cycling, you would feel too, oh, I have the greatest viewpoint. So now I need to have everyone acknowledge that I have the greatest viewpoint, and then everybody should be happy. Now what they're saying is, I would be happy, but see, the greatest viewpoint still needs the acknowledgement of viewpoints, that I am the greatest viewpoint, and then the lesser viewpoints acknowledging it. It's still a viewpoint. They're still trapped. There's no salvation there. So So all thanks to my teachers, to our teachers, the transmission of grace, Jesus, Longchenpa, Sri Sri Anandamayama, that this exercise is shared with us, is shared with us. And with us, I mean with every one of us, every one of us. We don't want to have the highest viewpoint. Absolutely not. We want to get free of this whole cyclic intertropic cycle stance of hallucination altogether. We want to set it aside, gently set it down. The last thing we would want is to reach the highest viewpoint in all of this, because that's, in some ways, you could say that's the most severe delusion. I mean, so certainly don't want to be stuck in any viewpoint, including the lower viewpoints, which are truly miserable. Feeling subservient to the higher viewpoints, you see. We don't want to be subservient either. We don't want to be grandiose. We don't want to be subservient. We want to be free of all viewpoints. We want to be released from release in the now, free now, which is, you know, freedom, utter freedom, which is what we are. So when you practice this, make sure you're insisting upon it and you realize it is freeing you from the viewpoint of worshiping some high viewpoint. See, I am greater than any viewpoint. I am greater than any high viewpoint. I am greater than any low viewpoint. I am greater than any viewpoint. I am greater than any non-viewpoint. I am greater than any in-betweenness. So this feels like a root practice, doesn't it? Like a really basic practice that is extremely helpful. It's a phase four practice. Phase four is you realize that phase five is no phase at all. It's kind of a realization of phase five as no phase at all. No viewpoint at all. Everything self-released. So we rest. We are released from even resting, from an absence of anything brought to rest. Anything brought to rest. Right? Nothing can be brought to rest. Everything is inherently at rest. All is inherently at rest in the perfect freedom. The immutable, immaculate freedom. All is inherently at rest, always. So in any exercise, we know there will be a struggle, that we're supposed to be a struggle. That's why we're kind of like scared exercise. Oh my God, I'm gonna struggle. But it's like if you go out jogging, you know you're going to feel it, right? Sure. So use your will for tolerance for strain on spiritual practice like this, instead of physical activity, instead of whatever else it is that you try to push yourself. Because you only have a certain amount of tolerance for pushing yourself. Don't try to do it all. This is a big mistake that we make right now. We're making it worse than ever. This is the conceit, the devious, devilish conceit of the modern age, is that we can do it all. This is not true. We only have a certain amount of tolerance for strain. Therefore, if we strain ourselves in our career, in our relationships, in our recreation, in our traveling, in all sorts of ways. If we strain ourselves in those ways, we will use up all our tolerance for strain, and we won't have any left for these spiritual exercises, which are actually a great strain. The only way I can do these is because I have, renounced strain in other directions. But of course, this brings up all the tolerance I can stand. These exercises, like, wow, that's a lot of strain. But not too much. We do have some tolerance. All of us have some tolerance for strain. We must place that tolerance on spiritual exercises such as this. The ordeal of preparation, the ordeal of going through these phases, we must put our tolerance there. And we must be practicing. Do not get caught up in the mode of, well, what about the analysis? That's not practicing. No. I'm greater than any analysis. I am greater than any analysis. Being just this mode of I am greater than mode. I'm greater than any analysis. I'm greater than any non-analysis. I'm greater than any in-betweenness. So when I talk about this modern age being a disaster, it is. It is a huge disaster, which is just binding us to this entropic cycle even more so, which is terrible. It's all a compulsion, actually. Even though there's seemingly higher levels and lower levels in your cycle, you say, I'm going up to the higher levels. It's all a compulsion. It's all fear-driven. It's all fear-based. It is all fear-based. We don't want this. We do not want it. The disaster of this modern age is this devious deception that we can do it all. We can do it all. This, for example, the feminism, is... The basic principle is expressed through feminism very strongly. I can do it all. I can do it all. I am woman, hear me roar. I can do it all. We've heard this so much. I could do it all. I can be super mother. I can be super wife. I can be super CEO. I can be super fitness. I can be super hostess. I can be super socialite. I can be super devotee. I can be super worldly. I can be super spiritual. I can do it all. This is the devilish conceit. Perverse intellect, devilish conceit. This is what's ruining. This is what is binding us to this entropic cycle so terribly. We do not have tolerance to do it all like that. Absolutely not. This is overlooking the continuity, fear, and the pragmatism entirely. This is just conceit, devilish conceit. We cannot do it all like that. We have a pragmatic problem, a continuity problem. We only have so much tolerance for strain. And if we're going to excel, we can only really excel in one direction, one area actually. Because the whole idea of truly excelling is you are really putting yourself through strain, maxing out on strain. Maxing out. You cannot excel in all ways. This is delusion. Devilish conceit. This is the attitude of the world, is the attitude of very devilish conceit. Driven by the devilish conceit of the higher part of the cycle, wanting to impress everyone about how their viewpoint is the greatest, you see. This drives it. We think, wow, I need to be in association. I need to be in relationship, association with this high viewpoint or something. Not true. I'm greater than any association. I am greater than any relationship. So, you must say, I cannot do it all. I cannot do it all. I have a very severe continuity problem. I cannot do it all. In fact, I can only do one thing, which is the vision of oneness. That's all I can do. Vision of oneness is all, the only goal I can reach. See, I have a very severe continuity problem. The vision of oneness is the only goal I can reach. Say it that way. The vision of oneness is the only goal I can reach. I cannot do it all. The vision of oneness is the only goal I can reach. Now, so what I'm saying is the tolerance for strain is limited, very limited. We reach a point where we say, no more. I just can't have any more. When we're young, we get deluded into thinking we have endless tolerance for strain. So we often get preyed upon when we're young by those who have this high viewpoint. Thinking, oh yeah, you know, you can do it all, you can do it all. And they get hooked on worshiping this high viewpoint. Well, you must say, no, I cannot do it all. The only goal I can reach is the vision of oneness. That's it. Because as we try to do it all, we become vulnerable. We don't have the will, the tolerance for strain to do these kind of exercises. So we fall prey to those who have this temporary high viewpoint in this entropic cycle. We fall prey to them. Okay, as spiritual teachers, as etc., we think, oh, yeah, I need to have the viewpoint that you have the highest viewpoint. We fall victim to that. So as a culture gets more and more into I can do it allness, they become more and more vulnerable to these false messiah archetypes. Both spiritually, politically, socially, in every which way, we become more and more vulnerable. But if we accept that, you know, I just can't do it all. No, I can't be a great person even. I cannot be a great person, I can't. I'm greater than a great person, but I cannot be a great person for you, for anyone. The only goal I can reach is a vision of oneness, that's it. Then all our will and our tolerance for strain will be placed towards that goal. We do have, again, tolerance for strain. And these exercises do put us under strain. There's no question about that. They're supposed to. Keep it focused, very simple. Keep it very simple. It's possible to be pulled in too many directions, even, you know, on the spiritual path. You need to do this and 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 this. And you lose your tolerance for strain for the one important exercise that you really need to do. And then you fall victim again to a false messiah. So the phase four is really freeing ourselves from the whole false messiah complex that is inherent, endemic in this whole entropic cycle, which is supporting the stance of hallucination. And so here we have to gather our will for these very profound exercises, these simple profound exercises. We have to gather our will for just this one viewpoint. I only have one problem. I only have one goal. I have one problem, one solution. One problem, one goal. One practice, one goal. That's it. So we're simplify. I'm not going out reading all these books. I'm not getting some library. I'm not going out all this. No. Simple practice. Full stop in the burn of that strain. And leave all these other strains. Forget it. I don't even have the strain of work right now. I don't have any work. And it's been that way for quite some time. But did I just take it easy? No. I put all my effort into the strain of this, you see. That's why they have monastic retreats and all of that. These monastic orders. The strain is all concentrated on simple spiritual practice. Not spreading themselves too thin. That is to be avoided. So, the rabbit that's jumping all over the place, strained this way, strained that way, trying to be super everything, finds that they're unable to handle the strain of these kinds of exercises. They say, oh, they do it superficially. Oh, yeah, I can't do that. I don't know. Then they sour grape it, rationalize why they can't do it. See, the tortoise is not jumping all over the place. The tortoise is just very straight and narrow. As Jesus said, straight and narrow is the way. When I saw Longchenpa coming to me in a dream, I saw him walking across this very narrow and straight causeway across this great ocean. Very narrow. I said, wow, how's he walking on that? And it was like level with the water. It wasn't high above the water or anything. It was right at the surface level of the water. And he was just walking smoothly across this very narrow way. Both sides of him, this vast ocean of samsara, delusion. Samsara and nirvana, actually, the cycling. Cycling is samsara and nirvana. That's what we're cycling. That's what we're trapped in. And I just watched it. This arrival of this person, I had no idea who it was. I was just watching him walk across this very narrow causeway in the middle of this great ocean coming towards shore. And I was so impressed by this. I said, wow, you really know the way, don't you? As I asked him, is the water hot or cold? He says, both. And I said, hey, I'm going to listen to this one. I'm going to hear. I want to hear what this one has to say. Narrow is the way. For sure. Meaning, it's a strain. We have to put our strain in just this narrow focus. So this devilish conceit of the modern age is really ruinous. As I impress this upon, I've been pressing this constantly my whole life. This is ruinous. It's ruinous. It's ruinous. It keeps us bound so badly because we spread ourselves too thin. And the genius of grace is that it progressively releases us from all this distraction. Releases us from books, releases us from music, releases us from teachings, releases us from greatness, releases us from endeavor, releases us from all of this. So we're able to concentrate our attention on very simple and yet very strainful practices that enable us to get comfortable with the truly inexpressible that is freedom. The viewpoint freeness that is freedom. We are free of samsara and nirvana, both. We are free of the high and the low. We're free of both delusion and non-delusion. Non-delusion as a viewpoint. We're free of all of that simultaneously. It's a simultaneous freedom. It is not a cycling up to a higher viewpoint. It is a freedom from high viewpoint and low viewpoint, both. Even the depths of samsara has some viewpoint. We're free of all viewpoints. Simultaneously, this is the whole key. We rest in perfect simultaneousness, in perfect coincidence. and perfect coincidence. Absolute coincidence. Non-causal. Non-causal coincidence. So in your gathering of your will, you must even gather your will and release it from the teachings of one who says, I am the greatest, I have the highest, greatest viewpoint, and I'm going to concentrate all your attention and strain on realizing that. You must also set that down too, because that most certainly will strain you so badly, you're not able to do this true release, get comfortable from the true release, from all release. Release from release, actually. It is truly the release from release, since there's nothing brought to release, nothing brought to rest. And this constitutes, you know, the great delusion that there is this, as I had this experience of abiding in non-dual absoluteness, I was aware that there is this dynamic there, this this dream, small little area in the infinite spaciousness, tiny little dream, but the dream seems to be full of excitement and passion and bliss and saying, wow, I got this answer, you know, I got this answer. It's relative to the darkness, it's a dream of light and darkness, high viewpoint, low viewpoint, and the seeming, the movement and the potentiality of that. And this is what intrigues us. We say, wow, no, that isn't released as it is right now. No, that has some causation, some goal. No, no goal, no causation. Spontaneous, coincident release. The release of release. Released, released. In the absence of anything brought to release. See? This is the practice, okay. And as one who has been stuck in this, I certainly understand its application. I realize there is this pull of the release from samsara by nirvana. There is this pull like that. But as Longchenpa points out beautifully, no, samsara and nirvana equally and spontaneously released in the now. Nirvana is just a viewpoint too of release from samsara, but that is still delusion actually. There's never been any non-release. There's never, a non-released event is impossible. So, I am greater than any hero. I am greater than any guru, greater than any avatar, greater than any messiah, greater than any savior. I'm greater than any viewpoint. I'm greater than any highness. I'm greater than any release. I'm greater than any freedom. Greater because greater in absence of anything being brought to freedom. Okay, I'm greater. I am released from greatness in absence of anything being brought to greatness. I'm released from freedom in absence of anything being brought to freedom. And I'm released from release in absence of anything being brought to release whatsoever. So the strain is there. It is here. So your tolerance from strain, this is very, I haven't seen this before, but it's been, I just hadn't been identifying it clearly. It's aware of it, but is the trick that you get tricked is to spread yourself too thin. You must. Put your focus on what is truly effective and experience the strain there. Now, the strain rhythm of this was not bad for me at all. It was not bad, surprisingly. I said, wow, come on, okay, then bring it. I want more. Somehow the strain is not bad at all, which I guess is good. I'm trying to find some practice that brings the strain even, you know, intensely. But it's smooth, pretty smooth, a little bit. So that means the progress has been made. Absolutely, progress has been made. Significant progress has been made here by really concentrating in. But there is some burn, so just full stop in the burn, full stop in the burn. Just, I give everyone an opportunity in the videos to just kind of stay with it. Don't say, go off into something else. Just stay with it. Because this has brought some shake-up, there's no question. Maybe it's just deeper than we know. I'm not feeling it at the surface so much. Just the very fact that there is a way to practice this is a shake-up. Like, wow. There is a way to get free, so to speak. There is a way I can practice getting ready for freedom. Remember, the Holy Spirit is the real teacher. Okay. Always, from a pragmatic standpoint, rest in that. As long as we have need for pragmatism, the Holy Spirit is the true teacher. Okay. So if someone says, worship me, no, don't do it, don't do it, don't do it. Put all your attention on me, put it, no, don't do it, don't do it. Put your attention on the exercises and the practices. Put your attention there. The teacher is the Holy Spirit. So, as far as like Longchenpa, what is Longchenpa? Longchenpa is someone who helps with the practices, who is very beneficial, very beneficial. But the teacher is the Holy Spirit. There's no confusion about that. Longchenpa is a teacher who has no need to be seen as a teacher. See, no need to be seen as a teacher whatsoever. These are the real teachers. No need to be seen as a teacher whatsoever. And then when you don't have a need to worship any teacher, then these teachers show up. Because those who have no need to be seen as a teacher, we might say, well, you're not that great. You know, I want a high viewpoint. They say, there's no viewpoint. I'm just suggesting and encouraging, please, very modestly and kindly, that you can be helped if you do some exercises. There can be some help, a lot of help derived from that. I'm just shedding some light on this, just naturally and gracefully shedding some light on this for all beings. Just shedding some light on this for all beings. That's all. No need to. So when you feel that, you say, ah, this is helpful, thank you. So be careful of anyone who is basically taking your attention off of the Holy Spirit, trying to replace the Holy Spirit. Be very cautious of that for sure. Maybe more than cautious. The Holy Spirit resides within everyone, put there by God. The Holy Spirit will see that everyone is saved. Will be there till the very end. That is the real teacher. The real teacher is the one that will stay with us until all of us are free, you see. Never forsaking even one of us. That is the one and only teacher there is. That is the one and only teacher there is. There's only one. There's one and only teacher, and that is the Holy Spirit. Now, when you hold to this position, then the help you get are those that truly acknowledge this and have no need to be seen as a teacher whatsoever. And from that standpoint, they can pragmatically share with us. They can share what is helpful with us. They can say, hey, I've been there, done that. I am now free of that. I'm now in freedom, experiencing true freedom. And I very much support what the Holy Spirit is suggesting, actually. See, the Holy Spirit is suggesting all this to us. Like this morning, I asked the Holy Spirit for this exercise. It gave me this exercise. But I was able to say, oh, this fits in very well with what Longchenpa is saying. And that helped me. I said, okay, I'm not alone in this. I'm not all alone. I'm not crazy. I'm not alone. So the Holy Spirit has helpers, as I put it. The Holy Spirit has helpers from a pragmatic standpoint that help us out and say, well, I'm not all alone. So the Holy Spirit has exercises that knows it will help us. But it knows that we'll think, oh my God, this is just too much. There's nobody else. And so it says, well, look here. Here's Longchenpa. He totally understands this exercise. You're not alone. You're not alone. And I say, oh yeah, that's right. And so then I have the courage to actually do the exercise, insist upon the exercise. So this is how the Holy Spirit works. The Holy Spirit certainly uses helpers, pragmatic helpers, pragmatic help, pragmatic help. So I say, yeah, okay. In other words, if I do this, insist upon this exercise, I know Longchenpa will understand and say, yeah, I understand that exactly. I understand exactly where you're coming from with this. And I say, oh, that's good, good. Validates the Holy Spirit. So we need, pragmatically, we need validation of what the Holy Spirit has to tell us. We need validation pragmatically. But that's all it is. It's just pragmatic validation. It's just pragmatic validation. So, as radical feminism arose, as it did, and there was, I don't know if there's ever been a more virulent demand arise. It's just those who went through it, you know, rising in the 70s, really, you know, it was just like, wow. Talk about getting hammered. And then I became aware of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma at some point. It was actually in the late 90s where we had to make a decision of which way we're going to go. You know, for a long time, radical feminism, I say, wow, what is this? Is this good, this bad? I mean, this is hard to figure out what's going on here. So in 1997, I became aware of a pragmatic helper. Pragmatic helper. And what Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma was saying is, look, I have appearance of a female appearance. Okay. What I'm telling you is put all your effort into the spiritual path. Don't spread yourself thin on any of these other goals that radical feminism is saying, which you can do it all. Okay. You should support what radical feminism was saying. You should support the ideology of doing it allness. And you should support women who want to do it all. And Sri Sri Ananda, my mom, being a woman, the parents of a woman here, said, no, you focus on the spiritual path exclusively. So she was the great foil to radical feminism. But I needed that because I needed a woman to stand up and say, hey, no, you focus all your efforts and strain on the spiritual path. Forget about everything else. You can't do it all. And she said, leave me out of this. Okay. Because she basically could do it all, being absolute freedom. You see, it's different. She said, leave me out of this. Do not allow anyone to use me as an example of doing it allness, is what she said. You leave me out of this. I'm only here to insist you cannot do it all. You focus on the spiritual path exclusively. Okay. And she said, I'll help you. And she did. She did. She said, I'll send you my Shakti, my Maha Shakti, to work through this doing it allness, which I did. It was pretty crazy, to say the least. But I did it. And so she helped out incredibly. Had no spiritual ego. No need to be seen as a teacher. She said, leave me out of this. Don't see me as a teacher. Don't see me as a guru. Just pure pragmatism. Pure pragmatism. Don't try to do it all. So I wouldn't be here if she hadn't helped me, for sure. I would not be able to focus on this. No way. And the same with Jesus. 1978, Jesus started this path of saying, hey, you need to focus in on this Course in Miracles, okay? Forget about the other books. I was reading, you know, just everything. And when I came across Course in Miracles, we gradually only focused on that. All the other books, forget it. Same thing with the music. I was into so much different music, and the Holy Spirit said, hey, focus in on only this music. And so I focused in on only this music, very narrow focus. And gradually, I got free of music altogether. Gradually, I got free of books altogether. Gradually, now my whole focus is on these exercises. Which this is where the potency is. And as Jesus says, that doing the exercise is where the potency is. And he had absolutely right. But even more potent is getting down to only a few exercises. And the ultimate potency is even just one. You know. But let's not be idealists here. Let's be pragmatic. You know, let's not just constantly focus on the ultimate. But no, we need to get it down to a few. Keep condensing it. Keep condensing it. Where the strain, where the burn is. Relentlessly stay there. So I say three great helpers, Jesus, Sri Sri Ananda, my mom, Longchampa, three great pragmatic helpers in support of the Holy Spirit, which is the grace of God. Sri Sri Ananda, my mom, called me the grace of God. God's grace is everywhere. God's grace is always with you. You must abide in that grace. Christian tradition, we call it the Holy Spirit, but also the grace of God. In Buddhist tradition, they call it the compassion of pure, you know, compassion of pure spaciousness, the compassion of pure clarity, the inherent compassion of pure clarity, the grace of God, the Holy Spirit. That is always present with us and will always be present with us. It will never leave us. That is the real teacher. So as you feel you're condensing your life, you think, oh my God, it's going to be too difficult. No, keep in mind, you're letting go of all this strain, other strain. So you keep thinking, no, I have to do these exercises too? That's too much. Not if you let go of the other strain and all the other directions you're straining yourself. Then it is not too much. It's only when you try to do it all that it's too much. And so what gets thrown out of the window, the baby gets thrown out of the bathwater, and we're trying to do it too much. What does radical feminism say? Oh, well, you'll have to let go of these spiritual practices then, because this other stuff is, we must do it all, and that's too difficult for you. It's straining you, so you don't want to do the other stuff. You got to get rid of that. Some people say Sri Sri Narayana was a model for radical feminism. No, she was the foil for it. She's what frees us from that, actually. Very nicely, kindly, not saying a bad word about anyone or anything really, but very insistent. As is Jesus and Longchenpa, very, very focused, very focused. Focus on this, focus on this. Focus on this. Focus on this. Of course, while doing the exercises, full stop, and then out, my mind is starting to wander a little bit about what I can do next. And somebody called me up once to get together for lunch, and I start thinking, no, but this is enough. This is enough. This video is enough now. This issue of the strain is so all important. I'm seeing now, absolutely. So choices are necessary. Choices are necessary. Can't do it all. Can't do it all. Can't do it all. Don't support those who are trying to do it all. Do not support those who are trying to do it all. This is all important. Support those who are only trying to do one thing. Reach the goal of vision of oneness. That's where all the support has to go. This is your salvation. Do not continue to support those who are trying to do it all, because you're supporting your own delusion. You're supporting being bound to delusion. Because you can't do it all either, you see. And if the atmosphere and the ambience and the culture and the teaching, everything is about you can do it all, you will get caught up in that. And then you will not have the capacity, the strain, the focus to handle the severe strain here in these exercises, because this gives you all the strain that you can handle. Blessings upon everyone, all places, all times, all situations. That's it.